गुड इवनिंग, गुड इवनिंग। सो नाउ वी विल स्टार्ट द क्लास।
गुड इवनिंग सर।
गुड इवनिंग, गुड इवनिंग। दिस व्हाइट बोर्ड इज, दिस स्क्रीन इज विजिबल ना?
यस सर।
यस सर।
ओके
वीडियो
फाइन।
एंड ऑडियो ऑल बोथ आर ऑडियो।
गुड इवनिंग सर।
गुड इवनिंग, गुड इवनिंग यू ऑल। नाउ सी, इन लास्ट क्लास वी डिस्कस्ड अप टिल दैट मेंडलीव्स पीरियडिक क्लासिफिकेशन एंड वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द ड्रॉबैक्स ऑल्सो एंड नाउ वी हैव टू स्टार्ट आई थिंक मॉडर्न और मॉडिफाइड पीरियडिक क्लासिफिकेशन ना? दिस इज येट टू स्टार्ट ना?
Sir, we wrote 4 points, sir, Bohr classified elements.
Oh, fine. That S and P block elements, D block elements, F block elements, and zero group elements. This all we have done. Okay, fine. And we discussed about valency also, na? Valency with respect to hydrogen and valency with respect to oxygen and halogen.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So see, it was very important. With respect to hydrogen, valency first increases 1, 2, 3, then 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Here you wrote NaH, here you wrote CaH2, here it is BH3, here it is CH4, here it is NH3, here it is H2O, here it is HH, HF, HCl, HBr. So see how many hydrogen atoms are there. That will be the valency of the element. Sodium is having one valency, calcium 2, boron 3, carbon 4, nitrogen 3, water. In water, oxygen is having valency 2, and in HH, halogen will be having valency 1 because one hydrogen atom is attached. Now this was our first point. This was our first point, that 1, 2, 3, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Then one more was there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 0. Valency of element with respect to, this was with reference to, with respect to hydrogen, and this will be with reference to halogen or oxygen. Oxygen or halogen. See here, we have to give examples accordingly. Here you will be writing NaCl. How many halogens you have taken? 1. So the valency of sodium will be 1. Here it will be MgCl2. Here it will be AlCl3. Here it will be CCl4. Here it will be PCl5. Here it will be SF6. Here it will be IF7. So like this, you have to give its example in support of your answer. Here you can't write PCl3. Here you can't write PCl3. Here you can't write SF2, SF4. Here you can't write IF or IF3 or IF5, IF7. Can only be written. So you have to write that point only through which you can prove your point right. So accordingly, you need to write. Now see this with respect to halogen you have written. Now see with respect to oxygen. Na2O, two atoms of oxygen, sorry, two atoms of sodium are having valency 2 because the valency of oxygen is 2. So two atoms of sodium will be having valency 2, one atom will be having valency 1. Here it will be BeO, oxygen valency is 2, so the valency of beryllium will also be 2. Here what you will be writing, you will be writing Al2O3. Here what you will be writing, you will be writing CO2. Here what you will be writing, you will be writing N2O5, P2O5. Here what you will be writing, you will be writing SO3. Here you can't write SO2. If you will be writing SO2, then you will be proving your point wrong. So you have to justify your answer, so it should be correctly written. What about this one? What about this one? This one, Cl2O7. See, the valency of oxygen is 2 and the valency of Cl is 7. So in this way, you have to give you have to support your answer, you have to justify your answer. So accordingly you should write example. So this already we have done. So that's very important. This valency is a very important some basic concepts in chemistry, and in 12th class also it will be playing very crucial role. On Sunday only we started this chapter, na? When we started this chapter?
On Sunday.
So this will be a second class, na?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I have logged out from the class.
Sir, your screening
has stopped. Sir, your screen sharing is stopped.
Fine. Actually, it was taking time. So by mistake, I'll do. Now it is shared, na?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So now we will be doing the rest of this modern periodic table, modern or modified periodic classification, as we have already discussed. About the Bohr's classification. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine. Now, see, in a modern form periodic table, this is your modern periodic table. In this long form periodic table or modern periodic table, these are S block elements, P block elements, D block elements, and here it is F block elements. These are lanthanides, and these are actinides. These are 4F inner transitional series elements, these are 5F inner transitional series elements. Now see, in this entire, how many long form periodic table, how many periods are there, how many horizontal rows are there? Periods or horizontal rows are 7. And how many groups are there? That is vertical columns. Vertical columns groups are from 1st to 7th. And in 1st to 7th, A and B both are there. And then other than this, 0 and 8th group is also there. In 8th group, triad is there, iron, cobalt, nickel, 3. So this 1 to 7 is A and B, that is 14. This is 15 and 3, 18. Total group number there in long form periodic table is 18. So 18 groups are there. First A, B to 7th A, B, that is 14. Then 0 group, and then 3 triads of 8th group, total it will be 18. So periods are 7 in number and groups are total 18 in number. Iron, cobalt, nickel here, group number 8, group number 9 and group number 10. Group number 8, group number 9 and group number 10. That's 8th group. Which group it is? It is 8th group. That is iron, cobalt, nickel, palladium, platinum. Then this is 28, this is 46, this is 78, iridium is 77, osmium is 76, ruthenium is 44 and rhodium is 45. So 27, 26 plus 18, 44 plus 32, 76. Here also same. So this is transition. This is transition group. This iron, cobalt, nickel is, this is transition group. This iron, cobalt, nickel is transition group.
So meaning of transition?
Transition means in between. Here some groups are there some groups are there. In between these 10 groups, these three are there. Transition means in between. And this is about this long form periodic table. 2, 8, 18 and 32 are called magic numbers. Why these 2, 8, 18 and 32 are called magic numbers? Because after every 2, there is a repetition of electronic configuration. Because of after every 8 number, there is again repetition of electronic configuration. So after these 2, 8, 18, 32, there is repetition of electronic configuration. That's why these are called magic numbers. So 3s2, 3p6, what else you can write? 3d10. According to above, obviously you'll be writing that after 4s only, but in third shell 18 electrons will be there, then again 4s2, 4p6, 4d10. Like this you will be writing electronic configuration. So after every 2, 8, 18 and 32, there is repetition of electronic configuration. That's why these numbers 2, 8, 18 and 32 are called magic numbers. See, this is your first period, this is second period, this is third period, this is fourth period, this is fifth period, this is sixth period, and then seventh period. These are different periods: first period, second period, third period, fourth period, fifth period, sixth period, and seventh period. In first period, there is only one element. There is only one element, that is hydrogen. That is hydrogen. In P block, this is first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth. Now see, in first period of this F block, only helium is there. All these are vacant, empty. Here it is P block. So here it is hydrogen, here it is helium. Then lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, neon. Helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, radon. Here hydrogen, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, francium. Beryllium, magnesium, calcium. This is magnesium, calcium, barium, strontium, then barium, then radium. Then here boron, aluminium, gallium, indium, thallium. You need not to remember atomic number, just add numbers 2, 8, 8, 18, 18, 32. Carbon, silicon, germanium, tin, and lead. Nitrogen, phosphorus, arsenic, antimony, and bismuth. Then oxygen, sulfur, selenium, tellurium, polonium, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, and astatine. Now see, in this first period, how many elements are there? Two elements are there. Only two elements are there. So it is very short period. What it is? Very short period. In the second period, how many elements are there? Eight. Second period and third period are having eight elements. So it will be known as short period. These two periods are known as short periods. In this fourth period. In this fourth period, how many elements are there? 10 here, 2 here, and 6 these elements. So total 18 elements. So this is long period. This is long period. Fifth and sixth periods are called long periods. Fifth and sixth periods are called long period. Sorry, not fifth and sixth. Fourth and fifth periods are called long period. And in this sixth period, this is sixth period. In this sixth period, 32 elements are there. So it is known as very long period. And seventh period is still incomplete period. Seventh period is still incomplete period. So will be known as incomplete period. Incomplete period. So first shell is having two elements, so known as very short period. Second period is having only second and third period is having only eight elements, so will be known as short period. Fourth and fifth period is having 18 elements, so will be known as long period. And sixth period is having 32 elements, so will be known as very long period. And seventh period is still incomplete, so known as incomplete period. These F block elements, that is lanthanoids and actinides, that is 4F inner transition series elements and 5F inner transition series elements are known as rare earth elements. F block elements are called rare earth elements. Now see, this is all about the modern or long form periodic table. On Sunday we discussed so many things, and now we'll be going to discuss some more points related to this long form periodic table. Now see, magnesium is known as bridge element. Why magnesium is known as bridge element? Why it is so called? Because it is linked between calcium and zinc. Third period elements, that is calcium and zinc, it resembles with calcium, second A group element, as well as zinc, second B group. Since this magnesium resembles to calcium and zinc, calcium is second A and zinc is second B group element, that is why magnesium is known as bridge element. See how you can say it is bridge element. Ionization energy, if you write in kJ per mole. Ionic radii in picometer. Here you will be writing calcium, this is zinc, and here it is Mg. Ionization energy of calcium is 590 kJ per mole, and ionization energy of zinc is 900 kilojoule per mole. What about the magnesium? Magnesium will be having 738, that is less than zinc, lesser than zinc, and more than calcium. So this magnesium is having lower than zinc ionization energy and greater than calcium ionization energy. So will be bridge in between calcium and magnesium. What about the ionic radius? Ionic radius of calcium is 100 pm and of zinc is 74 pm and magnesium is 72. See here this point you can't justify, na? Only ionization energy you can justify. So this point can't be justified. So it is not applicable for all properties, but certain properties will be resembling with calcium and zinc, both second A and second B group element, calcium and zinc, both resembles in their ionization energy with magnesium. So this was bridge element, why magnesium is known as bridge element. This is one point. Then one more point is there, that is typical elements. What typical elements are? I already told you S and P block elements are known as normal, typical, or representative element. there I was not able to explain you what the meaning of typical is, but here we will get the chance to discuss about typical. Third period elements, what typical elements are? Usually elements of third period. Third period elements, for example, sodium, magnesium, aluminium, silicon, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine. Sodium, magnesium, aluminium, silicon, phosphorus, sulfur, and chlorine are true representative of groups. Means this sodium a true representative of groups means this sodium there in hydrogen, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, francium. So this entire group is known as sodium family. Why? Because sodium represents the properties of entire group. It won't be known as lithium family, it will be known as sodium family. So sodium belongs to entire group, not lithium, in terms of properties. So like this, magnesium family, aluminium family, silicon, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine, etc. These are the true representative of their respective groups. So their group will be known on their name only. Sodium family, magnesium family, aluminium family, silicon family, phosphorus family, sulfur family, chlorine family, etc. Sodium belongs to the entire group. Lithium does not belong to the entire group in terms of properties. Fine. So this is about the bridge element and typical elements. Now see, you discussed so many things about the modern periodic table, that how many groups are there, how many blocks are there, how many periods are there. Fine. So now we'll discuss about the defects of the modern periodic table. Defects or demerits or drawbacks of modern periodic table. First point, the position of hydrogen is still uncertain. That's also still not sure even in modern periodic table also. Position of hydrogen, that's why it is known as rogue element or wander element, because it is not having their own home, not fixed position. Then second point, similar elements are separated. Similar elements separated. That is BA and PB. Same properties. Their properties are same, but their position is different. But they are placed there in second A and fourth A. Barium is placed there in second A and lead is placed there in fourth A. But their properties are same, but their position is different. Barium is placed there in second A and lead is placed there in fourth A. So similar elements have given different position, then many dissimilar elements placed together in the same group. Dissimilar elements placed together in the same group. That is Cu, Ag, Au are there in first B, and alkali metals, that is sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, francium are placed there in first A. But these are heavy metals show variable valency, and S block alkali metals are light metals. Their density is very low and they do not show variable valency. So similar elements have given different position and dissimilar elements have given similar position. These were the drawbacks of this modern periodic table. Metals and non-metals do not have any separate position. Metals and non-metals do not have separate positions. All are mixed in same group. How you can say this? See, this is your P block now. These are metalloids, these are metals, these are non-metals, and these are inert gases. So all the four elements, metalloids or semi-metals, metals, non-metals, and inert gases are there. They are in the same block. So that is what they have said, that metals and non-metals have no separate position. All are mixed in same group. Now see fifth point, eighth group, position of 12 elements of 8th group. Is in between 7th group and 0th group. So that also we can't justify, because all the 12 elements have given the same position. They are in the 8th group and they are placed in between 7th and 0th group. Lanthanoids and actinoids are there in 3rd B. Sixth point, last drawback, all lanthanoids and actinoids are in 3rd B. So all are placed together. No individual position has been given to lanthanoids and actinoids. Now see, we'll talk about the diagonal relationship, which we wrote there in Mendeleev's drawback, that Mendeleev's periodic table was unable to explain variable valency and diagonal relationship. See, first we'll discuss about variable valency and then we'll talk about the diagonal relationship. Variable valency. See, as I told you so many times, S and P block elements do not show variable valency. S and P block elements do not show variable valency. D block elements show variable valency and F block elements show variable valency. Why S block elements do not show variable valency? Because there only NS subshell is partly filled or completely filled. So only NS electrons will be taking part there in the bond formation. What about the P block elements? In case of P block elements, their NP subshell will be partly filled. So their valence P subshell will only be taking part there in the bond formation. So in case of S and P block elements, only NS and NP subshells will be taking part there in the bond formation. What about the D block elements? In case of D block elements, NS and N minus 1D, both subshells are partly filled, so both can take part there in the bond formation. Since their two subshells are partly filled, so two subshells can take part there in the bond formation. So obviously the number of valency will be more there in case of D block elements. D block elements, that's why show such a large number of variable valency, because their NS as well as N minus 1D, both subshells can take part there in the bond formation. What about the S and P block elements? In case of S and P block elements, only one NS or NP subshell can take part there in the bond formation. What about the D block elements? In case of D block elements, NS, N minus 1D, both subshells can take part there in the bond formation. What about the F block elements? In case of F block elements, NS plus N minus 1D, N minus 1D, and N minus 2F, all the three subshells can take part there in the bond formation. In case of F block elements, valence S, penultimate D, and pre-penultimate or anti-penultimate F subshell, all the three subshells can take part there in the bond formation. That's why F block elements also show such a large number of variable valency. So it is D and F block elements only which show such a large number of variable valency, because there more than one orbital more than one subshell takes part there in the bond formation. What about the remaining elements? In case of remaining elements, only one subshell will be taking part there in the bond formation. That's why they show what type of valency they show. What type of valency they show? They show group valency. Means entire group will be showing the same valency. First A group, hydrogen, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, all are showing valency 1. What about the second A group elements? Beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium, radium. They will be showing valency 2. They will be showing valency 2. So they will be showing valency 2. First A group will be showing valency 1. So like this, their entire group member will show, all members of the group will show the same valency. That is why in case of S and P block elements, what type of valency they will be showing? They will not be showing variable valency. So you can't say that they show non-variable valency. You can't say that they show constant valency, fixed valency, definite valency. No. Instead of using all these words, what should you use? What should you say? You should say group valency. I have written group element. That's wrong. Group valency. What you should say? They show group valency. So opposite word of variable valency is group valency. That's there in NCERT. So just please, that's very uncommon word. Students usually do not know this, but they can ask you this too. Instead, as I already told you, sodium valency is 1. But if suppose 1 is not given, what else they can give you? They can provide you group valency. If 1 is not there, then what answer you will be writing for the valency of sodium? Group valency. Valency of oxygen is 2. If 2 is not there, then what answer you can write? That group valency. Oxygen show group valency. Means all members of the same group, oxygen family, will be showing this valency, that is 2. So in this way, you can explain why D and F block elements show variable valency, while S and P block elements do not show variable valency. So this was one of the drawbacks of the Mendeleev's periodic table. Another drawback there, we were unable to explain it. So another drawback was that Mendeleev's periodic table was unable to explain the diagonal relationship. Mendeleev's periodic table was unable to explain variable valency and was unable to explain diagonal relationship also. So now we'll talk about diagonal relationship. See what diagonal relationship is. Lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, francium. Then write beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium, radium. Then what next is? Next is boron, aluminium, gallium, indium, thallium. Don't take D block elements, just take only S and P block elements. Then what next is? Next is carbon, silicon, germanium, tin, lead. Then see this lithium resembles to magnesium. This is diagonal relationship. Beryllium resembles to aluminium, and this boron resembles to silicon. Fine. Then carbon resembles to phosphorus, but that's very, very less. So first, second, third, fourth A group elements. First A, second A, third A, and fourth A group elements show diagonal relationship. Lithium resembles to magnesium, beryllium resembles to aluminium, boron resembles to silicon. What's the reason? What diagonal relationship is? Diagonal relationship depends upon polarizing power. What polarizing power is? Polarizing power is ionic charge upon ionic radius square. Ionic charge upon ionic radius square. This is polarizing power. So polarizing power is equal to ionic charge upon ionic radius square. Ionic charge upon ionic radius square, that ratio is called polarizing power. directly they can ask you what polarizing power is this point. This question was already there in entrance examination. So this on this polarizing power only diagonal relationship depends. Since this lithium and magnesium both are having same polarizing power, this ratio of ionic charge and ionic radius square, that ratio there in lithium and magnesium is same. That's why they show diagonal relationship. Their properties will be same. So then in first day we will discuss that what properties lithium and magnesium resembles. Fine. So beryllium, aluminium, also boron, silicon, also they are in different groups. We will talk about those diagonal relationship, their resemblance with each other. They are in different properties. This all we will discuss there only. So this was about the diagonal relationship and variable valency. Now we go to the next screen. Now, see, there is one more topic next to this, that characteristics or properties of, now we'll be talking about the properties of S block elements, P block elements, and D and F block elements. We'll study all of them together. Properties of S block elements. Then P block elements, D block elements, and F block elements. Properties of S block elements. See, many properties. What properties you know, we will be talking about those properties first. S block elements are light metals. You can their density is very low. That's why you can say that light metals. You can call them soft metals too, because even by using knife you can cut them. So easily you can cut them. That's why you can say soft metals or light metals. Their valency, their MP and BP low. Low MP and BP. They do not show variable valency. Usually S block elements are colorless. White or light color. In 12 points itself, we discussed about this all. Na? Colorless, white or light colored. These S block elements are strong reducing agents. elements. Now next point, their oxides are acidic. Basic. Oxides of S block elements are basic. Their radii will be highest. This we'll talk there in periodic properties only. So their radii will be maximum, their size will be biggest. So like this, for P block elements, you'll be writing many properties. Here, instead of writing light metals, here metals, light metals, non-metals, semi-metals, that is metalloids having the properties of metals as well as non-metals, and inert gases, all are there. Their MPBP will also be relatively low in compared to transition metals, low MP and BP. They also do not show variable valency. They are also most of them colorless, white or light colored. They are reducing agents as well as oxidizing agents too. they are reducing agents as well as oxidizing agents too, but their oxidizing power is very well known. Fluorine, oxygen, all these are highly electronegative elements na, so they are very strong oxidizing agents. Their oxides can be, their oxides can be acidic, basic or neutral. Their oxides can be acidic, basic or neutral. What about the D block elements? D block elements are heavy metals. D block elements are heavy metals because their density is high. Their density is very high, so high density. And their MPBP are very high. Very high MP and BP. They show variable valency. They show variable valency. They show variable oxidation state. Most of them are colored. Most of them are colored and most of them are paramagnetic in nature. Most of them are paramagnetic nature. Their magnetic moment won't be equal to, their magnetic moment won't be equal to zero na. So most of them are paramagnetic in nature. Their oxides are generally basic. Basic oxides. Their oxides are generally basic in nature. So in this way, many more properties you can write. Here I am just writing very few are very, very good catalyst. Good catalyst. Good catalyst transition metals are used as a very good catalyst. So many more properties of D block elements we can write. F block elements also, what properties we wrote for D block, the same properties will be of F block. Variable valency, variable oxidation state, colored, paramagnetic, magnetic moment won't be equal to zero, and melting point and boiling point will be very high, and most of them are radioactive in nature, do not found in earth crust. So we have to synthesize them. Most of them have to be synthesized, are man-made elements. So like this, we can write so many properties about the F-block elements. So this is all about the properties of S-block, P-block, D-block and F-block elements. So hardly this question there in entrance will be of 3 marks, 4 marks. For 3-4 marks, this many points are more than enough. So this was all about the properties of SP, D and F block elements. Now we'll be talking the next point. This was all about the periodic classification. This was all about the periodic classification. So now periodic classification is over. Now we'll focus on periodic properties. Now we'll focus on periodic properties. Now we will be focusing on periodic properties. See, second part of this chapter is periodic properties. Periodic properties. See, one is atomic radii, atomic size, atomic volume, ionic radii, ionic size, ionic volume. Ionic volume, then covalent radii, van der Waals radii, van der Waals radii and crystal radii. These are the first 9 periodic properties. Now I'll explain all of them together. see the radii of atom is atomic radii. Radii of atom is the ionic radii. That is always one dimensional. Radii will always be one dimensional. All radii are one dimensional only. What about the atomic size? Atomic size will be the size of atom. That will be two dimensional. All sizes will be two dimensional. What about the atomic volume? Volume of the atom that is three dimensional. Ionic volume will also be three dimensional. So radii of atom will be atomic radii. Radii of ion will be ionic radii. Size of atom will be ion will be ionic size. Volume of atom will be atomic volume, and volume of ion will be atomic volume, ionic volume. So what the difference between radii size? All are one and the same, just the dimensions will be different. Atomic radii only one dimensional, atomic size will be having two dimensions, volume will be having three dimensions. That is what I have written this all over here. Now see these six points are over: atomic radii, atomic size, atomic volume, ionic radii, ionic size, ionic volume. All are one and the same, but we should know that their definition. What covalent radii is? See, these two covalently bonded atoms are there. Distance, average of the distance, average of the distance between the nuclei of two covalently bonded atoms. Average of the distance of the two covalently bonded radii at nuclei will be known as covalent radii. So average of the distance between the nuclei of two covalently bonded atom is called covalent radii. If these two atoms are neighboring atoms, they are there in a crystal lattice. So that is the average of the distance between the two neighboring atoms, they are in a crystal lattice, is called crystal radii. Average of the distance between the nuclei of two neighboring atoms, they are in a crystal radii, in a crystal lattice, is called crystal radii. Then what van der Waals radii is? Van der Waals radii is the average of the distance between the nuclei of two physically bonded atoms. That is called van der Waals radii. So listen once again, what covalent radii is? Covalent radii is the average of the distance between the nuclei of two covalently bonded atoms. What crystal radii is? Crystal radii is average of the distance between the two neighboring atoms in a crystal lattice. What van der Waals radii is? Van der Waals radii is the average of the distance between the two physically bonded atoms. Average of the distance between the nuclei of two physically bonded atoms is called crystal radii. Now see here what you said, covalent radii. Covalent radii will be minimum, will be smallest, and then crystal radii will be bigger than that, and then van der Waals radii will be the biggest one. So this also they can ask you, van der Waals radii means atoms are physically bonded. Since atoms are physically bonded, so closeness, that much closeness won't be there, so will be biggest one. And in covalent radii, covalent bond is the strongest bond, so atoms will be closest, so the radii will be the least one, and crystal radii will be bigger than covalent bond, will be bigger than covalent radii and lesser than van der Waals radii. Actually the bond there in crystal lattice is stronger than van der Waals force of attraction and weaker than covalent bonding. So that's why there is difference in radii also. Is this clear? Any doubt? Students, is there any doubt? Students, am I audible? Can you hear me all? Am I audible? Am I audible, students? Am I audible, students? Am I audible, students? Can you hear me? Oh, fine. Okay, fine. Fine. Thank you, Tejas. Thank you very much. But no one else responding me. What does, whether they are getting me or not? Am I audible to you all? Okay, fine. Now see, so these nine properties are one and the same. Their trend will be same. So not today exactly, tomorrow I'll be explaining about their trend. They are in the periodic table, they are in the periodic properties. So I explained about them, what atomic radii is, what atomic size is, what volume is, what ionic radii size volume is, what covalent radii is, and what van der Waals radii is, crustal radii is, and their trend also I explained that covalent radii will be the least one and van der Waals radii will be the biggest one, because van der Waals force of attraction or physical force of attraction is the weakest one, so atoms will be most distant from each other. While in covalent bonding, that covalent bond is the strongest one, so their force of attraction will be maximum, so atoms will be very close to each other, so covalent radii will be minimum, covalent radii will be the least one. Is this all okay? Should I go to the next one? Fine. Fine. I am not getting no one's voice. I am not able to listen you all. My everything is in order, but I don't know what the reason is. So now this all is over. Now see, one thing I want to explain in short. See, this is nucleus. This is nucleus. This is nucleus, and these are shells. These are shells. In shells, electrons are there, and in nucleus, proton is there. So since these two are oppositively charged, so there will be attraction between the electrons. They are in the orbit and nucleus, protons, they are there in the nucleus. So there will always be attraction between them, that is called nuclear charge. And you can say it is effective nuclear charge. Tendency of the nucleus to attract this valence shell towards itself, that is called effective nuclear charge. More the number of the protons, more the number of protons, more will be ENC. And lesser will be the number of electrons, more will be the effective nuclear charge. If number of electrons are more, then ENC will be less, and if number of protons will be more, then effective nuclear charge will be more. So obviously there will be contraction. This valence shell will move towards the nucleus due to ENC. So what ENC is? ENC is the tendency of the nucleus to attract valency, this effective nuclear charge is the tendency of the nucleus to attract shared pair of electrons towards itself. Now one more point I want to discuss. Here electrons are there, there also electrons are there, so between them there will be repulsion. This valence shell tends to come closer. This valence shell tends to come closer to the nucleus, but these valence electrons will further push it outward. This valence shell tends to come closer to the nucleus, that is called effective nuclear charge, but this penultimate shell will push it outward, that is called shielding effect or screening effect. So here I was trying to tell you the difference between ENC and shielding effect or screening effect. ENC means valence shell tends to come closer to the nucleus, and as it comes closer to the nucleus, this penultimate electrons will push it outward. That pushing of penultimate shell to this valence shell outward is called shielding effect or screening effect, and this movement of this valence shell, attraction of this valence shell towards the nucleus, that is called ENC. So effective nuclear charge, and these are the two opposing factors, effective nuclear charge, that is ENC. So ENC and shielding effect both works there in opposite direction. This is nucleus, this valence shell tends to come closer to the nucleus, this is called ENC, and this valence shell will, this penultimate shell push this valence shell outward, that is called screening effect or shielding effect. So there will be competition between ENC and shielding effect, which will dominate. Any one can dominate, and if one dominates, if ENC dominates, then there will be impact on properties, and if shielding effect will be dominating, then there will be impact on the properties. So accordingly, we'll keep on discussing about this all. So we'll start with a fresh of this periodic properties, and this all you should, what I told you, you should remember this all, and then tomorrow we'll continue the same. Fine. Thank you very much, you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sir, end the recording.
Yeah.